I speak to you in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Today's readings from the Old and New Testament and the Gospel are all intertwined with each other. All three readings are centered on faith. The Old Testament speaks of the story of Abraham and God's request of him to leave his homeland of Ur and travel to a strange, unknown land which God will show him. And by going to this strange land, God will make of him a great nation and make his name great, and he will be a blessing to all. And this move Abraham and his family were making was going to be permanent. They were never going back. And Abraham made this move having no idea of what he was getting himself into. And he did it when he was believed to be in his 70s. So if you think you're too old, you're not. He made this move when he was in his 70s, not knowing what to expect, but being convinced that God had spoken to him and given him a promise. And yet, when Abraham decided to relocate, there was no guarantee that God's promise would be fulfilled. All he had going for him was his faith. Abraham went on obedience and faith. It was because of Abraham's faith that he said yes to God's request. It was because of Abraham's faith that he said yes to God. It was because of Abraham's faith that resulted in his acting upon God's promise. He didn't argue. He didn't hesitate. He simply believed in his heart that God knew what he was doing. And he obeyed. And he went in faith. And then we come to the second reading, in which Paul, in his letter to the church at Rome, deals with the whole notion of faith and works, and uses Abraham, that same Abraham, a person whom every Jew revered and would understand, the one who is seen as the founder of the Jewish nation, Paul uses him as an example as to what makes a person right in God's sight. And he states that Abraham did nothing to deserve God's promise. It was not because of his work or what we do as prescribed by the law that makes us deserve God's promises. It's our faith, as it was Abraham's faith, that causes us to take God at his word and believe that God still loves us even when we have found, when we have done nothing to deserve that love. And Paul knew that we all have fallen short of the glory of God, for we all sinners. But because of God's love and compassion for us, he put a plan of salvation in place through the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Abraham believed in God, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness, or as the Message Bible, which Eugene Peterson transcribed, and I quote, "He trusted God to set him right instead of trying to be right on his own." He trusted God to set him right instead of trying to be right on his own. And what Paul is saying is that it isn't our works that make us right with God. It is our faith, our belief in God. It isn't about doing all the things that would gain us points with God. The man whom God chose to be the one to take his people to the promised land was a man who heard God's call and responded in obedience and faith. even though he did not see or know or understand God's plan and where it will all lead. And as we know, Abraham didn't see it. But God chose this man, not because of any good works he had done, but because of his faith. His faith to venture out into new and unknown and unfamiliar territory. We live in an age that some of us may find it difficult to believe that a man will simply obey God and pick up everything and leave what he has known. But Paul tells us that is the kind of faith that God expects from us. That is the kind of faith God expects from us. A faith that is similar to that which a child has for a loving parent. And it reminds me of the story about a father who was awakened one early morning by the smoke detector in his house. And he woke up his wife, and then quickly they went to their children's bedroom and woke them up and started heading for the door through the smoke, which was getting quite heavy. And the father was carrying his 1.5-year-old daughter in one arm and held the hand of his 4-year-old son with the other. And as they were coming down the staircase, his son, who was scared and unsure of what was happening, pulled his hand from his father's clasp and ran back upstairs to what he thought was a place of safety, a corner of his bedroom where his favorite toys were kept. The father got outside and called to his son, who appeared at the bedroom window crying and calling for help. And the father called out to him and told him to jump from the window. But the boy yelled and replied, "But I can't see you, Dad. I cannot see you, Dad." And then the father called back with a reassuring message, "That's all right, son. I can see you. Just jump." The 4-year-old boy put complete confidence in his father when he told him to jump from the window, even though he could not see his dad and had no idea where he would have landed. And this brings us to the story of Nicodemus. In the gospel reading today, a man who is one of the learned Pharisees, a leader of the people who knew and applied the law, a man who was devout. And people listened to him and followed him, and he had a powerful position in society. And he comes to Jesus, which says something about his courage, because a Pharisee will never want to be in Jesus' company unless he came to trick him or test him. So even though Nicodemus showed courage by coming to Jesus, instead of approaching Jesus in the day, Nicodemus came to him in the night. Maybe because he feared being seen or ostracized by his fellow Pharisees. But nevertheless, his coming to Jesus in the night goes deeper than just not wanting to be seen by others. It appears that Nicodemus was spiritually blind and confused, unable to comprehend what Jesus is teaching him. And we see that up front. When Nicodemus begins to tell Jesus that he knows he comes from God because of the signs he does, Jesus doesn't say, "Well, Nicodemus, I'm glad you know that." Instead, Jesus immediately confuses Nicodemus even more by telling him no one can see the kingdom of God unless he's born from above. No one can see the kingdom of God unless he or she is born from above. In other words, born anew, born again. And Nicodemus takes this to mean, how can an old man like me do this? How can I re-enter my mother's womb? And not only that, but how can I break all those old habits that I have? those beliefs, those convictions. You see, Nicodemus is in the dark when it comes to understanding how God works. He comes to Jesus with his own convictions and tries to put Jesus into his way of understanding how the world works and how God works in it. And the only answer he can come up with is that Jesus must come from God. Somehow he believes that Jesus is the real deal, but he's still confused because even what he assumes doesn't fit in with what he believes. So Jesus moves Nicodemus in a different direction, in a different way, to see how God works. He tells him about repentance and the baptism which John the Baptizer preached, and how no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and the Spirit. And he also tells him to shift his focus from the things of the flesh to the things of the Spirit. Shift your focus, Nicodemus, from the earthly things to heavenly things. We are to shift our focus from the temporal things to the things eternal. And this was new to Nicodemus and no doubt difficult to change. And we may ask, did he ever exercise that type of faith or became a true follower of Christ? And we are unsure. It doesn't appear that he became one of Jesus' visible followers, where he followed Jesus in the day when Jesus was going around. But it does appear that he never stopped admiring or caring for our Lord. And this is evident in John chapter 7 and verses 50 to 52, when he defended Jesus to the other Pharisees and priests, asking them to give our Lord a fair trial, which surprised his Pharisee friends, and caused them to ask him, "Surely you are not also from Galilee, are you?" And as we all know, nothing good comes out of Galilee. And the Pharisees continue to say, "Search and you will see that no prophet is to arise from Galilee." And then you see Nicodemus again, hearing about our Lord. For we find in John chapter 17 and verses 38 to 42, Nicodemus is at the cross with Joseph of Arimathea, a secret disciple of Jesus. And they are preparing Jesus' body for burial with a very large amount of spices. My friends, in essence, the faith that Jesus calls us to have and to emulate is that of Abraham. That same faith which Abraham showed when God told him to leave his homeland to go to another, not knowing what to expect, not knowing where he was going, not knowing how it will all pan out. And we need that same faith of the child who is willing to jump through a window from a second floor, even when the smoke is preventing him from seeing his dad. We need to have that same faith which Paul counts as righteousness. For instead of trying to be right on our own, we trust God to set us right. We need to exercise that same faith. It is that same faith that is needed in the kingdom of God. It is that same faith which moves us to focus on the things that are eternal instead of on the things that are wasting away. We focus on the things of the Spirit instead of the things of the world, the things of the flesh. And regardless to whether we call it being born from above, or being born again, or being born anew, or being saved, or being baptized, or being confirmed, our Lord is saying to us that we need to be born of the Spirit. We need to be born of the Spirit. For what is born of the Spirit is Spirit. And when we are born of the Spirit, we are able to spiritually see and hear, discern and understand, believe and follow, speak and live out Jesus' message of love and reconciliation, and to live that out in the world. Because we have the kind of faith that Abraham had, which allows us to believe in the promises of God and the promises which His Son, Jesus the Christ, has left with us. Amen.